Hello and welcome to another Portworx demo. This one is about a feature that we're releasing in 2.1 called asynchronous replication, all for disaster recovery. So this specifically will be forming incremental asynchronous backups from cluster to cluster in Google Kubernetes. So here you can see we have two different clusters. One is in US East 1D, and the other is in US East 4C, and we'll be pairing these two clusters up. One will be our DR cluster, the one in US East 4, and the main cluster will be in US East 1. The top and bottom terminals are our two clusters. If I go to the source cluster and get the nodes, you can see that they are part of a pool here, and then if I do the same thing on the destination cluster, they are part of a separate pool, just to show you that we're interacting with two separate clusters with three nodes each. Now we'll go ahead and take a look at the Portworx clusters on each one of these Kubernetes deployments. Here we have PX cluster 1, and it's operationally up and okay with three nodes and a bunch of storage. And on the destination cluster, we can see the same thing, except different name, but it's up operational with three nodes and a bunch of storage. Next, what we'll do is take a look at our cluster pair. This demo, we're not going to set up the cluster pair. I can point you at another video that shows exactly how to do that. But in this case, we're taking a look at our cluster pair available in the MySQL namespace, which pairs our storage and scheduler, which allows us to send volumes as well as Kubernetes objects from one cluster to the other on a schedule or when we want to and those type of things. In this case, we're going to set up incremental backups for disaster recovery. So we need an application first. So we'll just go to the Kubernetes example of WordPress and MySQL because we get a couple volumes out of there. The first thing, we just need to make sure there's a secret for MySQL. I've already put this in the source cluster ready to go. So if you look at the get secrets in the namespace, you can see MySQL password here. That's available to the pod that runs MySQL. Next, we're going to actually deploy MySQL. Now, I've taken the YAML here and updated the spec so that it uses the Portworx volume provisioner as well as reference the right storage class for Portworx so that our volumes are actually maintained and provisioned by the Portworx cluster itself. So now if we create that MySQL deployment, it'll go ahead and create everything that's in the spec. And we're on the source cluster here, so we can take a look at the PVCs. We have a single PVC for our MySQL database. It's bound and ready, so we can also look at our Portworx cluster and list the volumes. And we also see that same volume in Portworx as expected. And it is up and attached. So the pod should be ready. So if we go take a look at the pods in that namespace, we can see MySQL is up and running. Ignore the other one terminating. That was from a separate demo previously. Next, we're gonna deploy WordPress, which also has a volume, but in this case, we're going to use a shared volume. So you can notice that there is a annotation here for shared, which means it acts like an NFS volume and multiple containers, multiple WordPress front ends can access it. So let's deploy it. It will use that volume as well as connect to MySQL, which uses our other volume. Great, so we deployed it. We can take a look at our volumes again. And we can see that there's now two volumes. We use the namespace there. And one is read write many, and one is read write only, which we expect. We can look at pxctl again and list both volumes, and they're up and attached, so that means the pods are probably up and attached. And it is a shared volume. Great, so we can look at the pods and just make sure we are successfully running the application. That's great. Now we need to add some data, right? So let's use a little program called kubeforward to forward the ports to my laptop. And once we successfully forward the traffic, we can go to our local web browser and hit either of these services that we define in our YAML files. So we go to WordPress 80, we'll get our WordPress on our first cluster, which is yet to be set up. So we'll go ahead and just quickly run through setting it up with some fake information here for the username and the password, just so we can get into the application and add some posts so that we add some data to MySQL and things like that. Cool. Next, it's going to generate the website. I think this takes a few seconds. Should pop up here any moment and let us sign in. There we go. Let's sign in with username, password, very secure, and we're off and running. So now let's just add some data, meaning we're just gonna add a post called first post, just so that we can back up and restore this application and show that we have the right data in the application. Great, cool. The application shows our post. That means there's data there. So now if we go back to our clusters, now we need to set up the incremental backups for WordPress and MySQL from our source cluster to our disaster recovery cluster. The first thing you're gonna need is a policy, a schedule policy, which basically defines how and when you want to take these backups and sync them to the other cluster. So in this case, you can set an interval. I'm setting it for 1 minute for the purposes of this demo. So we'll get the data synced to the new cluster, and you also get a daily, a monthly, those kind of things. So you can define it in the spec like we saw there and create it via kubectl. Cool. Now it's created. We can actually take a look at the policy using storkctl as well. So if you get the schedule policy, you can see that the interval minutes, daily, weekly, and monthly. And you'll get logs and notifications. I'll show you in a second of when they actually sync. Then you need to associate that policy with migration, right? So we're gonna call this MySQL migration. We're gonna target the MySQL namespace where application is deployed. We're going to define the cluster pair that we showed before. So we're saying this migration should use this cluster pair, meaning it's paired with the cluster that is our DR cluster. And we want to send over the resources, meaning the Kubernetes objects and the volumes, but we don't want the application to start, right? Because we only want the application to really start using the volume in the case of a disaster. So if we create that schedule in the MySQL namespace as follows, we'll be able to take a look at what it actually creates next. So now if we'll dig into the actual migration in the MySQL namespace, we can see that it's already created a interval migration because it happens every minute. So this one's gonna happen pretty often for the purposes of this demo. And it uses a timestamp so you know how things are going. You can look at the migration schedules. You can describe the schedules to get a lot more information and the logs about what it's doing. In this case, we'll target the one we created. And you can see a whole bunch of information here about what resources it's using, what policy it's using, what the name of it is, and what the status of it. So what is it doing, right? At this point, it's actually backing up by our interval, and it says in progress. So now if we actually take a look, those should be the same as we saw before, and we can dig into that migration specifically in more detail. And you can see a lot of information here, but you'll get information about every object that it sent over to the disaster recovery cluster in the other zone, as well as information about what it is. So you can see the status talks about the secrets, the other Kubernetes objects like persistent volumes, whether they're in progress or already backed up. And the events will show you success or failure of those different events of migrating. Cool. So that migration seems to be off and running. Now, we actually want to use Stork as well to get some information about the migration. And this will tell you in a kind of a nice manner what cluster pair it's using, what stage it's in, what the status of it is, how many volumes or how many resources it's moved, and the timestamp. So what's cool is that if we take a look at the volumes in our destination cluster, which have the volumes being synced to it, we should be able to inspect the volume that was synced from our active cluster and show that it's being synced at the same timestamp, right? So we have a running application, we have the volumes, but only the volumes are being sent over to the new cluster, but we shouldn't be running our applications yet, right? Because we don't want to turn them on until a real disaster or something happens. So if you look at the pods in the namespace, they're not running, right? It doesn't mean those objects aren't there, it just means we haven't activated them yet in the case of a disaster. So we can take a look at the migrations again, and we can see it's kicked off a few more that were successful. If we inspect the volume, like I mentioned, we can see that the volume itself has the timestamp of the latest sync. So it's been syncing every minute, and that volume will be updated with the same timestamp. And you can check that on the destination cluster as it goes along. And if we just do it again, we can see it's kicking off another one currently in progress with another timestamp. So this again happens every minute, and I'm just showing you that you can see what stage it's in. In this case, it's the volume stage, and that'll snapshot and back up that whole volume. So now that we've actually migrated and synced our application over and over and over again, we wanna take the case of a disaster and restore our application. So you can see there's still no pods, but there is a deployment, right? But it's just set to zero. Now, if you want to activate your migration, you can use our storkctl command line and use storkctl activate migrations and target the namespace. This will turn up the replicas by one for the application. And you can see that the application is up and running, up to date, and available. So now if we go back to check on our pods, we can see that our WordPress and WordPress MySQL pods are up and running, which is awesome. And that will be using the volume that we've synced. So now if we forward the services from this cluster, which we've just activated our migrations that were continuously syncing, we can hit the website locally again that's forwarded from our DR cluster, and should get the data we expect, right? So here's the application and here's the post. So this will be running with the data of the latest sync that it's done. So that's the basic incremental use case for Portworx 2.1. Hope you enjoyed it. Until next time.